Hi, I'm Li Wei Yang. I'm the curator for Pacific Rim Collections here at the Huntington. And today we're with Lisa C, looking at the Lisa C collection, which contains over 300 glass plate natives from Los Angeles Old Chinatown, roughly from the 1890s to the 1900s. Lisa, can you tell us a little bit about the original provenance of this collection? How did it come to your family?
Yeah, I have a couple of theories about that. And of course, you and I have come up since we've seen the photos with the third one. The first is that when Old Chinatown was torn down to make way for Union Station, my father and my grandfather went scavenging. And they, you know, they just, the people had been given 24 hours to move. And so they left behind a lot, you know, just a lot of stuff. And so my grandfather and dad just, whatever they found, they brought home. And I do feel like this was one of the things that they brought home, and they just threw it in the shed. But then later, when we were looking at the photos, and I think on some of the ones that were printed, there was the address of 510 Los Angeles Street. And that was the location where our family store was for decades. And so that brought about the second theory, which was maybe when the photographer moved, he left that box of glass plates behind, because they are, you know, really heavy, really, really heavy, having moved them many times myself. So maybe he just left them on a shelf and our family moved in, was there for however long. And then in 1949, when that last block of Chinatown was torn down to make way for the freeway on-ramp, you know, stuff was packed up, went to different people's houses, and the family went in back to the store. And so it could have happened that way. And then we had that sort of third idea when you found in one of, again, one of the developed photos, a photo of 510 Los Angeles Street, the building there. But that is not the building that where my grandparents and the family had the store. So what I suspect is that between that time and the multi-story building that later was where our family store was, there was this interim building that looked to be, what was that, one story?
One story.
And that perhaps that's where the photographer was, since he obviously took a photo of it. What to me is so different about these is it's not someone on the outside looking in, it's somebody who lives in the community, who's part of the community, and is taking photographs of the things that he sees. Yes, he has his studio work, but he's also out there, you know, just a man crossing the street, somebody doing, carrying something somewhere, you know, a man with his child crossing the street, two people on bicycles, you know, kids, that's the stuff that he saw around him. I actually really love this one because it's that sort of early tourism of, yes, of Chinatown. And, you know, this woman who's come to ride in a kind of fake sedan chair. But again, he's looking at it, to me, he's just looking at it, at her and everything around it, not in an exotic way.
Uh-huh. Yes. Most of the photos that we have are mostly of men and children. Right. There are very few with Chinese women pictured in these photos, I think tells us something about the uniqueness of this particular photo of featuring this lone Chinese woman walking across the street in the busiest, one of the busiest intersections, right, in all of Los Angeles Chinatown. This could be a sex worker that was working in Chinatown at the time, and Los Angeles Chinatown was a place known for a lot of sex work, not only for Chinese as well too, for non-Chinese,
right,
as well,
exactly,
too. That's where they gather, that's where they practice their trade,
right,
and that's why I love this particular photo, just the way she's looking down on, she's aware of the camera and she's trying to avoid the gaze, trying to avoid attention, yeah, and the photographer is able to capture this moment.
Right. But I wonder if part of her looking down is not just about not wanting to catch the photographer's eye, but just staying within herself because it was dangerous to be out on the streets.
So Lisa, here we have a few photos of Chinese women being depicted. Some of them were taken outside, some of them were taken inside the studio. This one in particular is actually a print photo as opposed to a glass plate negatives. Can you tell us a little bit about the differences of the woman being depicted here? Mm-hmm.
Well, again, here's a woman outside. Her dress doesn't look, you know, like this woman's. From what we were talking about earlier, it was pretty rare for just a wife to be out on the street. She could have been like a servant. Mm-hmm. That was how I looked at that particular photo. But I don't know. And then here, you know, clearly it seems to me she's the wife of a well-to-do merchant.
I love the way that she's posing. In the background, you can see there's a stack of Chinese books.
Right, and she's holding one.
And she's holding one. And she is actually bending the Chinese mm-hmm. book, you know, as if she was reading them as mm-hmm. well, too. So something of this photo definitely tells us that this woman is perhaps of different status
yes.
when it comes to the woman that was being depicted out in Chinatown. And as you said, the way that she's dressed and the way that this whole studio prop is being set up, I think it just shows her confidence
right.
as perhaps she is the wife of a prominent Chinese merchant.
Yes.
We don't really know, but I think this particular photo, it's a very good example yeah. of what was taken by the photographer mm-hmm. in order to depict a woman of a high social standing.
Exactly.
And then do you want to talk about this one? It's a white American woman, presumably, and she is basically...
Well, she has something on.
There is something.
But she's definitely
she looks
there.
Like she's topless, at least from the shot.
Yes, and so who was that taken for? You know, we haven't talked yet about those more sort of formal portraits of men, but this would be, it's like the kind of equivalent. I mean, obviously it was done in the studio. So, you know, the formal portraits of men, there are a lot of reasons mm-hmm. that those were made, but, you know, to send them home to your family,
right.
Possibly for immigration, sort of official purposes. But this doesn't fit either of those categories.
It doesn't fit. It doesn't
you would not send fit. This photo yes. home to your family in Ohio.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things I love is all the children that are in these. So to have women, of uh-huh, course, uh-huh. but to see children in different aspects, you know, is he just kind of wanting this for posterity?
Yes.
Is he showing off?
Yeah.
Did he work there?
Yeah.
You know, here you have these little children and they're all dressed up. Those two little those girls in their matching outfits.
Yeah.
And at that time, you know, so few children, you know, if there are not a lot of women, there are not going to be many children
right.
either.
Right.
So anytime I think you can see, children in a kind of natural environment like that, you know, in a street, but also again the sort of more formal portrait. I know you have one with I think three kids in it, mm-hmm. and they're all dressed up.
Yeah.
And I can imagine somebody sending that home to the grandparents.
I think they're special because they're very different from some of our existing images of old Chinatown. You know, they're taken of buildings, they're taken by tourists, they're taken
right.
by white photographers at the time. But these ones, I feel like, because of the possibility, the high possibility that they were taken by Chinese American photographers who lives in Chinatown,
right.
who knows the place, who knows the residents, and the fact that these were photos commissioned by the Chinese residents as well,
exactly.
too. So I think the feeling is very different from the ones that we have. And that's what makes this collection so unique, is that they're so humanizing mm-hmm. about the people that live in Chinatown at the time. You know, they tell us a lot not only about the place itself, but then also reminds us about that exclusion was something that was overshadowing everything around this time as well, too. Mm-hmm. As the Chinese exclusion was going on between 1882 and 1943. And this collection, I think, captures so many different residents, so many different scenes, and
different classes.
Different class as well, too. Gender, like you were saying, so many children as well, too.
The other thing I would say about them is, you know, when you mentioned exclusion and this was such a difficult time to be here and all of the restrictions, including the fact that you couldn't own property. So, you know, the Chinese were and you couldn't live outside of Chinatown in many cities. And so that's how, why Chinatowns developed, was that you had to be in this enclave. And yet what you see from these is that even with exclusion, even with the restrictions, even with the racism and discrimination, people were going about their lives. And, you know, they were working, they were going out to dinner. I mean, all of the things that make life, life. And that, you know, riding out, taking a ride on a bicycle, you know, that it takes that time period. I mean, that time period is the frame around all of these, but that within all of the difficulties that people were facing, they found a way to build community, to enjoy themselves, and also just to preserve their lives in a certain kind of way, whether it was for to keep for themselves, to give away as a gift, to send back home to China, but also it's a way for us to know how they lived.